Senator Lucas was in Quitman, Georgia, when the Quitman 10 was going through hell on the backside of heaven.
All right.
And I'm going to be brief. I don't want to take much time, but the people who have internet, I'm saying to you, go to Boston GBR. Because as the senator has said, this is serious business.
It is.
You think that it's just coffee time, but God put me in the mix. And I'm stirring the political cake. And I don't like what's in the cake. When the Quitman 10 called me in Atlanta, say the sheriff department and the police, the GBI down in Brooks County done gone crazy. I went back to Quitman, walked the street, 80-some-year-old woman in Marvin, Georgia said she would never ever vote again because of the intimidation of the GBI investigators and the Secretary of State investigators.
Say it, brother.
Said she would never vote again. Wait a minute, I haven't finished yet. Then I was called to Madison. They had done the same thing to the Madison, Florida 9. Wait a minute. Got another call from Meigs, Georgia, with Mayor Linda Harris, a black woman. She already out of office. They done got rid of her. She violated no law. She was not found guilty of anything. But she's not in office. Wait a minute. Haven't finished yet. Then I was called to Lumpkin, Georgia, with Mayor Charles Gibson and the black clerk who got a story to tell about what they did to him, and as a result of the lies with the newspaper, he was not reelected. Wait a minute, haven't finished yet. Then I got a call concerning Chris Wright in Dawson, Georgia, who had been shot 6 times. Left in his yard for dead for whatever reason. And then he told me, I didn't get a phone call. He called Marianne Whippaloo and said, Ryan, you need to get over to Garden, Georgia. And so I went over to Garden, Georgia. And that's how I met Marianne Whippaloo and been over there ever since. And I'm telling you, she in a bag of hornet's nest that the world ain't never seen before. She got to fight her own black councilman, one of them. She got to fight the police chief. She got to fight every police officer. She got to fight Joseph Boone, the attorney. She got to fight the editor of the Wilkinson County Post. along with the chairman of the Democratic Party, DuBose Porter, for allowing all these lies to be posted in the paper. She got to fight a group of people called the Concerned Citizens, and she got to fight, as the senator said, he wouldn't call it because of his position, but I'm going to try to make it look clear. These Uncle Toms and Aunt Jane Negroes.
All right.
Wait a minute. I'll finish it. Then I was called to Warrenton, Georgia, with George Ivy. He's supposed to went to court Monday, but they canceled his court case. And I was planning to be in the courtroom, because when Mary Ann Whippledew go to court, I take this press pass by they law and stay in the courtroom unless they ban me out of it. So they just calling him ignorant and can't hold public meeting in the proper manner. So I'm just gonna skip that, the rush right along. Davisboro, Georgia. They were so scared they called me, but when I was supposed to meet with the council members and the mayor, they all got scared as hell, or hell. Then I was called to the little closer to Atlanta, Clayton County. I can't think of the brother's name up there, but they got problems up there too. Then I got a call, somebody told me they were watching the internet. They said, we've been watching you, Brother Ryan, to get to Free Press. They said, we got problems over here in Hancock County. I said, Hancock County? Where is Hancock County? So they came to Gordon, and they met with me. And I'm telling you, they had a story to tell. But I'm not going to tell it. But if you go to Boston GBR, you will see, as Paul Harvey would say, the rest of the story. Then I went to Homerville. Bobby Worthy was there. We got a councilman, white type, Witherspoon, got homestead exemption in Florida, homestead exemption in Lyons County, and holding office in, what name of the county? Clinch County. The county judge supported it. You can see all this on my YouTube channel. Wait a minute. Haven't finished yet. I think I done so called enough. But they called me. And I'm going to close out because I respect the time. But I want to close by saying this. There's a couple more, y'all. There's a couple more. There's equipment, too. There's a couple more. But let me say this in closing. The newspaper, the city and county attorneys, the television stations that go all the way up to Atlanta are also against these black elected officials. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna say it again. Mm-hmm. And I'm live on YouTube. I'm live on Facebook right here. Good. Everything is live on Facebook. You hear me, Facebook? And George Boston Rhyme don't lie.
All right.
I give you the truth, Facebook. Mm-hmm. The truth, YouTube. Mm-hmm. The truth, Loretta Lynch, the Justice Department, you ain't no good to us. Did you hear what I said? And I got the documentation to back it up. Eric Holder didn't come to Quitman and Quitman 10 plus 2. And none of these places that I called, the Justice Department was a no-show. And I'm questioning now the NAACP with Francis Johnson. I'm questioning the SCLC with my beautiful brother that I love so much, Mr. Steele. Don't get me wrong. Don't get me wrong. Facebook, I don't dislike them. I love them. And because I love them so much, I want them to show some love to these black women.
Yes.
To these black women who gave birth to the black man. Don't fool yourself. A white woman didn't bring me into the world. It was a black woman. So you ought to at least care for your own mama.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Make it plain.
Then I was called to
make it run.
This beautiful sister here, Douglas. I met her, and the newspaper had lied on her and how many others? How many more? About 13?
About 13.
They lied on 13 of them. And then when they had a press conference.
Yes.
Y'all, I'm in the church, ain't
you? Yes, sir.
Why not damn TV station, man? You know why? For your news ain't their news. If you were expecting Facebook, YouTube, white people to tell your story, you might as well forget it. They don't give a damn about you. What they want to do is set you back, in back of the back, and then on the back of the bus after all that back. I'm asking you all to vote straight ballot. Y'all, this thing is serious. And I'm going to tell you something about what the real deal is that anybody, very few people are talking about. Let me tell y'all what the real deal is. The white population, Facebook,
getting smaller,
is getting less and less.
What I said.
And we go to church,
I'm scared.
And it seems like our pastors, I'm sorry about you, right to my church, they don't catch it. Go back and look in your Bible. Understand what happened in Pharaoh's day.
Right.
What did they tell them people?
Uh-huh.
Pharaoh, kill who?
Male child.
The boy babies. What did they say?
Uh-huh. Jesus.
With Jesus, and I can hit some more points too. Who they say kill? The King Herod. He sent a decree out to do what? To kill the black babies.
Uh-huh.
They say, boy, baby, we know they were black folk. And so now they're doing the same thing again. Because they know your number is rising.
Yes.
So they put drugs in your community. And they put women in your community. And they tell you to find your man. They tell the women, go find your woman. You know why they tell them that? Because look, if you are increasing in numbers, right?
Uh-huh.
Two women ain't made many babies.
All right.
Two men ain't made any babies.
All right.
You don't find no black children with two.
Bad.
Y'all have it.
Okay, good job.
Appreciate it.
My name is George Boston Rhines, 5004 Oak Drive, Valdosta, Georgia. And I'm with the Get to Free Press. And my 2 minutes, I just want to use it to highlight, because I can't get into detail within 2 minutes. But Mr. Secretary and all you important people that are dealing with voting rights here in the state of Georgia, I just want to say, and I want to be on record, that there are major problems throughout the state of Georgia that I have identified that the news media mainstream will not report. I have been reporting it, and you can see it on Boston GBR YouTube channel. In Brooks County, Georgia, we have major problems voting, as well as trying to remove black mayors across the state. I'm working about 16 cities, Mr. Secretary. Quitman, Meigs, Lumpkin, Warrington, Gordon, Davisboro, Homerville. In Homerville, we have a sitting elected city council person who has two homestead exemptions, one in the state of Florida, one in Lyons County, Georgia, and he's holding office in Homerville, Georgia. These are impediments to the voting rights process. And across the state, the people and places that I've gone to, people are asking a question. What is the Secretary of State and others doing to resolve these problems that seem to impact and suppress the black vote throughout the state of Georgia? Also, Camilla, Georgia. I may not be able to call them all, but there's approximately 16 cities. And I believe that myself, a retired military veteran, I had no idea that this would be going on in 2016 to suppress, give the appearance of suppressing and controlling the black votes. And then after they get elected, the black mayors are seen to be under attack throughout the state. Now, I can prove this through video. I go to all of these cities at meetings. It's been documented, well documented. And so I'm going to take my seat. I think my minutes should be, 2 minutes should be up. And I already like to abide by the law because I'm a law-abiding citizen. Thank you, my beautiful secretary. And to all of you who represent voting process in the state of Georgia, the United States of America, we have veterans here. And I do believe that they should have a right to vote without the impediments and suppression. Thank you so much for this space, my beautiful brothers and sisters.
Thank you for being here this morning. Yes,
I think we should thank Mr. Ryan for his service to America.
Absolutely. We appreciate your service as well. All right, next we have Mr. Roscoe Allen Jr.
My name is Roscoe Allen Jr. I think.
Mr. Allen, if you don't mind, would you just give us your address?
My address is, 765. Visit address is 765 East Gresham Road, but I get my mail at P.O. Box 1906, Douglas, Georgia.
Okay. Thank you.
I do think the state need to put more heat on these supervisors and election board when it goes to vote. There's a lot of these stuff going on. And the reason why it's going on is because y'all not putting the heat where they did. See, like every year when it comes to election, the same thing happens. These different cities, y'all don't do nothing about it. It's time to get and do something. That don't do nothing. It's a big problem in the state of Georgia, especially around people around town like where I live at, in areas, it is a big problem. So y'all need to put the heat where it be at, you won't have all this problem, believe me. Anybody, no friend, whoever in charge, is about doing what they're supposed to do. It's legal, they're doing it legal, it needs to be done right. It's a big problem in the state of Georgia, believe me, down in my area, it's a serious problem. Every time election come up, it's always legal stuff going on with the election board. Supervise all of them. That's a fight. Because I subpoenaed people in election that lived in 20 miles out of the town. That's right, I did myself. 50 miles out of the town. I don't even live in the city there. You know, it's a big problem. I'm telling you now. Y'all need to put the heat with me. I don't care who it is. That's what y'all supposed to do. Am I right? Okay, that's all I got to say.
Thank you for being here. Last speaker during public comment, Reverend Larry O'Hara. Welcome, Reverend.
My name is Reverend Larry O'Hara. I reside at 1326 Roosevelt Street, Waycross, Georgia. I want to talk about Homerville, Georgia as well, but not just Homerville. I want to talk about all the little towns where the big problems are. Well, you may say where Atlanta, Augusta, or Columbus, that's where the city and that's where the most populated. But where the most populated is not where the problem is. The problem is little towns like Waycross, Homerville, Douglas, towns like that. The reason I'm talking about Homerville so much because I called the Secretary of State office several times myself. I've been calling for the last 10 years for voting fraud. Places like Willacoochee and Homerville. Homerville is so bad there that we caught this gentleman who resides in Florida, also resides in Georgia, but holding an office in a town that he don't have a domicile in. I called the Secretary of State office 3 months when we found out what he was doing and nothing was done about it. However, nothing was done about it. He went on and we went to their office. We talked to them, gave them the information that could not be denied, and they still allowed this man to run for office. And he was elected. Now that wouldn't happen in Atlanta. If I had went to a city commission or a meeting in Atlanta, they would have stopped it right then. But this is little Georgia, little town, the town that nobody pays attention to. Mr. Secretary, what I'm asking is that you would pay more attention to the little towns, not so much the big towns. I believe a lot of your problems was the size. That's all I have to comment.
Thank you for being here, Reverend. Okay, anyone else? That was all the cards I had.
Greetings. I'm George Foster Rhines, and this is the Get to the Free Press. Just want to ask you a question today. Have you ever heard of the Quitman 10 plus 2? Have you ever heard of Miss Luna Smart?
Prosecution changed the wording on the ballots to prosecute Lula Smart. The language was not there in 2010. They changed it on the ballot to make it look like she was guilty. The prosecution suppressed evidence.
Yes, sir.
They hid evidence.
Show they did. I'm a witness.
They did. Show them. Speak it. Tell the truth.
I believe that we ought to demand, as concerned citizens,
yes,
that they drop the charges on every remaining member.
Mr. Joe Wingate and Mr. Howard Lawson find nothing wrong with this. They find nothing wrong with this. How much can one community endure to have the right to have our votes cast and counted for who we want to represent us?
The Georgia Bureau of Investigation lied on the stand.
That's right.
Yes. Falsified documents.
That's right. Yes.
The Secretary of State lied on the stand.
Yes.
So did.
Yes.
Boone from the post office, who started this whole mess, lied on the stand.
Yes.
All to try to make these citizens look guilty.
District Attorney David Miller, engaged on a perjury. On the stand. You have the old voter registration lady, where she was taking ballots on the postcards. And once those ballots come in, those voters absentee ballots come in off. You can add a fourth person in there because she and her granddaughter helped the women.
These people's names have been tarnished, their reputation besmirched. They have been talked about, accused of different things, and now they are proven innocent. How are you going to get the horse back in the... How will you restore these people good name and reputation?
We want to show Quitman, as Africans, how we come together in unity and in celebration of those that we support and those that we love. We love the Quitman 12. We love what they're doing in the name of freedom and justice. So we're going to support them. I want everybody on their feet. I want everybody clapping their hands. I want everybody singing.
Sheriff Junior Odom held us in jail for 45 days.
Have you ever heard of the Madison 9?
This is KVCI.blogspot.com. I'm over in Madison, in Florida. And as you know, I've been following the Quitman 10, what's going on in Willacoochee. And we also down here in Madison, and they had a problem down here with the alleged voter fraud. And I just happened to got a call a few minutes ago, and I came down here. I see about 20 people here right outside of the courtroom. And you the attorney?
Yes, my name is Jane Coleman. I represent Raven Williams.
Okay, what was the purpose of today? Day meeting?
The purpose of today was to ask the judge to dismiss the information that was filed, dismiss the charges that were filed against our clients. Basically, our argument was that the state still wasn't able to allege in their information document, in their charging document, that a crime occurred, and didn't specify what the crime was. So what you saw today was arguments made on behalf of five defendants by three attorneys, and the state attorney was present, just asking the judge to dismiss the charges against them.
Okay. Where do you work out of? Where are you from?
I'm from Tallahassee, Florida. I work at a firm called Vieira Williams.
Okay. Now, we see that voter suppression allegedly is happening across the state of Georgia, apparently Florida, and perhaps the nation. How many people, first of all, are involved in down here in Madison?
Initially, we had 9 defendants. The state had made offers to made 2 offers, and those people took the offers. Everyone has been given the opportunity to, take a plea, but this is just so fundamental, so crucial, that we just couldn't accept a plea, especially when there was no wrongdoing or crime being occurred. All that our clients were trying to do was help people who otherwise would not have voted vote.
We understand pretty near the same thing happened in Brooks County, and I've been following that, and they filled the newspapers up with the fact that there was a spike in absentee ballots when the state of Georgia approved several years ago that anybody could file by absentee ballots. And that means that if everybody in the state of Georgia filed by absentee ballot, there would definitely be a spike in absentee ballots. Nobody addressed that issue. Nobody had published that in the local newspaper in South Georgia. And so it seemed as if though people are either ignorant of that law or they want to prosecute even the Quitman 10 or Quitman 12 now. And so it seemed like that Madison may be
I mean, I think it's exactly the same issue. I think I would go a step further and say it's just not about the law being changed, because absentee voting has been around for years. It's just the more the African American community utilizes it, the more it's becoming a problem. In 2009, 2008, whenever the presidential elections was, and African Americans came out in record numbers and voted for the first black president, that's when the laws started to change. And then Republicans, a Tea Party movement formed, and they started really looking at how is it that we can disenfranchise the black vote. How do we get less of them out there? So they cut down early voting, and they made restrictions that, you know, we would argue are unconstitutional on absentee voting. And so this is the effect of that.
There's been something else that I've noticed too, and you have to excuse me, I'm asking all of you all to forgive me, because this is the first time I did not have my camera with me. I keep it with me at all times, and so I personally believe that God had a purpose in us doing it like this. I really believe that. But when I heard this on radio, the conservative radio station this morning, and I called some people to see if it was actually taking place. That's why I'm over here. Nothing is published in the newspaper. Something that is important as voter fraud, alleged voter fraud. Why do you think, I'm not sure if it's here or not, but I know in Valdosta and Brooks County, it seems nothing is in the news about this. It seems like Quitman 10 the same way. It's all hush, hush. Why? Thank you.
Have you ever heard of the Madison 9?
You've taken my blues and you've gone. You mix them up on Broadway and fix them up in operas so they don't sound like me. Yep, you done taken my blues and gone. But someday, someone's gonna stand up for me and sing about me and write about me, black and beautiful. It'll be me, I reckon. Yep, it'll be me. Langston Hughes, Harlem Renaissance, for the blues people.
We are the blues. Everybody wanna sing my blues. Nobody wanna live my blues.
I'm down here in Willacoochee. This is KVCI, George Boston Rhymes. Still in the state of Georgia. As you know, over in Brooks County, there have been problems with the election process over there with the Quitman 10. You also know that the late Senator Robert Brown, through his support, along with Representative Tyrone Brooks, behind the Quitman 10. Senator Robert Brown said there was major problems in the state of Georgia concerning people that wanting to disenfranchise, apparently, the people in the state of Georgia. So I got a call a few minutes ago from the district coordinator, Larry Lockett. And so I'm over here in Willacoochee, Georgia, and I'm gonna let these representatives from the NAACP and other concerned citizens in this community tell you their stories because they know more about it than I do. Go ahead.
My name is Reverend Larry O'Hara from the Georgia State Conference of the NAACP. I'm here on the behalf of Mr. Hall. We have a clear case of voter fraud in Willacoochee, Georgia. Number one, Mr. Lay Futch allegedly paid individuals to vote for him. And you know clearly that's against the law. Number two, Mr. Lay Futch allegedly had individuals from Coffee County and Pearson, Georgia, to come over and vote for him in the city of Willacoochee. Number three, there are allegations that persons from Pearson, the neighboring city of Willacoochee, voted in the election for Mr. Butch. Now, how in the world could anyone from Pearson, Georgia, vote in an election in Willacoochee, Georgia? How in the world could someone from Coffee County, the neighboring county, come over and vote at a city election in Willacoochee? How can that be done? This is America. America, the country that I fought 22 years in the military for, and I went for that flag over there, and then I come over here in America and I got to come right back here and fight again in the United States of America. This is not a white America. This is not a black America. When you say that you're American, you don't say you're a black American, or you don't say you're a white American. You don't even say that you're a Mexican American. What you say that you are an American, and that's what you are. And Americans have rights. So let's stand up for our rights. Let's vote for our rights. Mr. Lay Futch should be in jail, for as I'm concerned. The NAACP want to bring this out to everyone, not just in Willacoochee, not just in the state of Georgia, but all over the United States of America. Not South America, not Central America, but United States of America. Things like that is not supposed to happen here. That is why we do what we do. The NAACP is here for rights, American rights. It don't matter who you are or where you come from. Here in Willacoochee, we want to fix that. We have our Lord and Savior that's above us, sitting up high and looking down low. Right now, we're asking him to look down on Willacoochee. Here is Mr. J. Hall. Gary Hall. This is Mr. Gary Hall. Mr. Gary Hall ran for the mayor of the city of Willacoochee. By right, he should be the mayor, but this voter fraud is holding him back. So now we got to go through all of these laws good ones and bad ones, laws from maybe as far back as 1800. But we got to go through all of these laws, what we call red tape, to fix this now.
This is KVCI. Now we want to hear from Mr. Hall.
Hello, my name is Gary Hall, and I'm talking about the mayor election that ran in the city of Willow Creek on November the 8th. And in the city election, we were running. And the thing is, on November the 8th, we had pictures that showing that the current mayor, the incumbent, that he was standing 15 to 20 feet on certain occasions. Also, we also had people riding around in the vehicle saying campaigning for Lace in his state car. And also, we have people that seen other Lace Butts give this certain person money. And that is not right. I feel like power and money ran the election.
Once again, it seems as if though the outcry is loud in Willow Creek. People are fed up, they're tired. In fact, they're sick and tired of being tired. And we just heard from, what's your name, my brother?
Gary Hall.
Okay, and you feel like you've been mistreated in what regard?
In regard to voter fraud and just conspiracy.
You feel like it's conspiracy. You feel like that justice has not been served, and there's a possibility of a total disenfranchisement of the voters, am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, what do you think needs to be done?
I feel like the right thing needs to be done is a re-election, either just give me the time, because I feel deep in my heart, and for the citizens speaking of Willow Creek, that it was wrongfully done.
And what's your name once again?
Gary Hall.
And you was running for the office of?
Mayor position.
Okay, now, your position, once again, what do you think needs to be done?
I think we should have another election. And I think Lee Butch should be in jail. By him being in jail, then he should be the mayor. See, this is the reason why it's so important for everybody to vote. People get out there and say, well, there is, well, my little vote, it doesn't matter. But your vote does matter. Every vote counts.
Okay.
He only lost by 2 votes after he had going to court. They took 2 of those votes away.
Yeah.
So now he's on a loss by 2 votes. There's no such thing as a runoff because only 2 people running.
Okay.
However, if just those 2 more people just sit there in their living room in front of the television eating popcorn or whatever they're eating, they could at least had a tie. And they had a better chance.
Now let me ask you again, what's your name?
I'm the Reverend Larry O'Hara, District 16 Coordinator for the NAACP.
Okay, now, before I get to my young man, what's your title, my brother?
Bobby Worth, I'm an investigator.
Okay, all right, good. Now, I want to definitely hit you, brother. But, where is Larry Lockett? Larry Lockett, you step around this man. I want to do this for a reason. Brother Lockett, why is it that I notice in the community here in South Georgia, it seems like to me that you're on top of everything? What made you recall me, number one? And number two, what do you think of the people standing behind you for taking on the initiative of voting?
The reason that I called you, Brother Brian, is because I know for us to get the word out throughout Southeast Georgia, throughout the United States, that we have to call for you. I know that it would take time to get the media here.
Yes, sir.
And what I see here today is really sad. That we don't have more citizens of Willow Creek, Atchison County, right in Willow Creek, Georgia, here in support of Mr. Gary Hall.
Yes, sir. All right. Thank you very much. So, with that as a back, if that is a lead, and now going back to you, what do you feel? Short form. Number one, short form. What is the problem over here? Number one, what happened?
Voter fraud.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that there was an election, right?
Yes.
Number one, there was an election. Then number two,
we set him up. We went out
have to pay these people to come in and vote.
Okay, you feel like people was paid to come in and vote for him, as you stated earlier. We want to make it very clear so even a little novice will understand to make it clear. Okay, so we have major problems. Now, Mr. Investigator, come on just a minute. What you stand right here? Your name is what now?
Bobby Worthy.
Bobby Worthy. Where are you from?
I'm from Blackshear, Georgia.
Blackshear. Did you drive all the way over here?
Yes, sir.
Did you get paid for coming over here?
No, sir.
Well, what make you come over here and tell us what do you think as an investigator for the NAACP, what this branch or this community needs to do? Tell us.
First of all, it's definitely voter fraud. Okay. It's racially motivated. What we have to learn as a people of color, not just black, but about white. Since white is a color too. Yes, everybody must look at this type of situation will not, and this type of behavior will not be tolerated from those public officials that we have claimed, that we have put our faith in to serve and protect this man. The whole city administration seem to think that the laws apply to them, that the laws only apply to the people, but that's not the way. The Constitution was written to protect the people from the oppression and the power of our government, not the opposite like the government seemed to think. And this is the problem. Over and over, county after county, is these people get these positions like chief of police and city administrators and mayors, and they think the law doesn't apply to them. The law applies to everyone. No one is better or above the law. If the president of the United States can be impeached, a mayor should be in prison. So what needs to be done is clearly the whole administration need to be put under federal review. Because this is definitely a crime. A crime is a crime. There's no crime that's greater than other. Ignorance, Georgia law clearly says that ignorance of the law excuses no one. Period. So they need to go to jail. Once again, why did you come here? Who sent for you? And who sent you here? I mean, how did you get here?
I came here through my district coordinator, which is Larry Lockett, and Reverend O'Hara, and Mr. Gary Hall. Okay. Mr. Gary Hall has filed the proper paperwork in the courthouse to challenge the election. That's what I'm saying. He, in return, the judge did not rule in his favor for some reason. The judge excused two of the people that found that they was taken off the ballot for fraudulent use, and still did not issue a warrant for their arrest. Not only does the city involve nines to become to a state court judge. Has committed treason. The law is clear. Any public official who willfully and intentionally violates their oath of office commits a felony, and shall any judge, when he acts where he has no jurisdiction, commits treason to this country. Wow. You all heard it, and your name is once again?
Bobby Worthy.
From the NAACP.
And I feel that the Justice Department need to come down on Willie Coochie, Georgia. They need to come down to Willie Coochie, Georgia as soon as possible.
Y'all have heard the district coordinator Larry Lockett. You've heard Brother O'Hara. You've heard another investigator from the NAACP. You heard the alleged victim who ran for the office of mayor feel like he's been mistreated. These people behind him feel like there needs to be something done. They've asked for the Justice Department. They've asked for the Secretary of State to come in. We're looking for justice in South Georgia. We want justice in Brooks County. And we know that the news media should be on top of this. They should not be waiting till next week. They shouldn't wait till next month. The news media in South Georgia, every one of them, should be here this day. But in case they are not here and we don't see them, kvci.blogspot.com. We're going to do what we do because we do it so well. Until next time. Bye-bye. Be gone. Power to the people and pass it on. And don't wait so long to get it on because we are on point when it comes to keeping you informed. Again, KVCI. Bye-bye. We're gone. I just had to go back because when we think about the country and the time in which we live, I just must get the feel of the sensation and vibrations in the state of Georgia in this particular area anyway. And so in doing that, I gotta acknowledge the people who put themselves in the limelight and on the firing line as well. They use their blood, they use their own gas to travel back and forth. So first of all, District Coordinator Larry Lockett, could you just
Well, I want all you presidents and former presidents that have served the NAACP, which is the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, which was set up in 1909, not just by black folk, but by blacks, white, Jews, and others. So identify yourself starting over here in terms of who you are. Everybody give their name and give your position because you had thought enough to come today. Right.
My name is Ernestine Thomas Clark, and I am the secretary for the Coffee County NAACP branch with 5184.
Larry Neesmith, president of Coffee County branch, 5184.
Okay. Reverend Ralph Best, I'm with the Waycross branch, number 5244.
Okay.
President.
Yes, sir.
Reverend Larry O'Hara, district coordinator, 16 of the Georgia State Conference of NAACP.
My name is Larry Lockett. I'm Georgia State Conference District 15 and 18 coordinator, and also I'm a member of the Waycross branch NAACP and a life member.
All right. Anybody else?
My name is Gary Hall. I was running for Ike for mayor, and I also was Ike the president of the NAACP for Ike County.
All right.
My name is Arthur Brown. I'm a branch of Winnipeg.
Alrighty. Okay.
My name is Bobby Brown. I'm a member of the Axon County NAACP.
Thank you, sir. And you in the back, sir?
Billy Hall, member of the Axon County NAACP.
Thank you very much. And once again, these are the freedom fighters of the civil rights movement of this era. And we have to understand that just because Dr. King left the scene, and now we understand on his birthday, people in the community come out, eat dinners and eat barbecue chicken and rolled up turtle eggs and talk about how good they are. But unless they are on the firing line, like these people are, your work and your time, in my most humble opinion, as a humble man, is a waste of time. And now, my beautiful brother, give me your final comments to all of this that's going on this afternoon. Before you give me your comment, I want to ask you a question. Was the media notified?
Yes.
Where are they?
I don't know.
Go ahead with make your point.
Okay. Well, this is the end of the meeting, but I'm going to say this here. If you're not, you know there's strength comes in numbers. It only takes one man to start a war, but it takes more to fight the battle.
Yes, sir.
So if you're not a member,
yes, sir.
Join up.
Yes, sir.
You can't do nothing if you don't join. And
that's it. This is KVCI.blogspot.com. George Boston Rhymes out of Valdosta, Georgia, the county of Lowndes. And I want to see justice not only here in Willacoochee, I want to see it with the Quitman 10. I do not want the work that Senator Brown did in Brooks County to be a waste. He committed himself to the Quitman 10 along with Tyrone Brooks, Helen Butler, David Lucas, who served 37 years in the General Assembly, and others. Even Reverend Joseph Lowry sent the People's Agenda group to Brooks County, all in support of the Quitman 10. But the South Georgia news media ignored all the great visits and all the great work of these historic legends in our community. I am here as a retired, as my brother O'Hara said, of the United States Armed Forces. I put my life on the line for over 20 years to fight for foreigners that I did not know. And I am determined to fight like hell for my own children and the citizens of the United States of America. And I intend to do that because that's what I do. And I'm doing what I do right now because you have a right to know. Peace be unto you. And bye bye, we go.
Thank you.
had never been, were not then, could never be citizens of the United States, and as such have no rights which white men are bound to respect. As such have no rights which white men are bound to respect.
My name since 2013, weekly in the Wilkinson County Post. I must say that Judy Bailey, who is the editor of that newspaper, along with the chairman for the Democratic Party for the state of Georgia, Dubois Porter, has allowed this to go on. And the citizens, now the constituents of the county, are now fed up because there are other issues that take far more precedence in the news than about what is happening to the mayor of Gordon, Georgia, you would think.
Well, similarly to Mayor Ripple, in my own particular city, it's a city of only 5,000 people, and there's just a single local newspaper, and the coverage in the local newspaper is consistently negative and subjective. Now, there are media outlets in Albany, which is 30 minutes away, and there's WALB. There are a lot of stations. They have been very fair in covering very positive things that I've done in the community. The fact that people who elected me, my approval among those people is enormously high. But if you look at the Camilla Enterprise, which is a local paper and a political paper, it only runs negative stories, as many negative stories about the mayors they run. And never in the history of the city has newspaper run negative stories on the mayor, except when the mayor, the previous mayor, was the first African-American mayor, a black female. Those same stories began. And in her tenure as mayor, my council asked her to resign. They didn't accuse her of any impropriety, but voted unanimously for her to resign. And the blacks on the council voted with them. So now I'm the second black mayor, and they are at the point where they're asking me to do the same thing. So it is clear that there are leaders there and individuals who simply don't want. And it's not the entire white community, but it is those who are, a part of the political leadership.
Wow, I am the poster model for the Times and Prize, Thomasville, Georgia. I'm in the paper. The paper comes out six days out of the seven. And I can tell you, I'm probably in there 4 days a week. And every time that I've been arrested, I've been blown up on the front page. And they have a little rant and rave area. And here lately, they've been saying there are more important things than what's going on with the mayor. They want other things in the paper. But every time they have an article, if they're talking about something with the council, they're already, the Karen Murphy, she's going to bring up the fact that I've been arrested so many times. I allegedly stole $80, and I've been arrested by the chief, and that's why I'm trying to get rid of the chief.
This Thomasville Times Enterprise, that reporter that you just mentioned, is this the same reporter that also said that you had handcuffs on and had your hands over your face, and come to find out that the video showed that was a complete lie?
The same lady.
Mayor Brown, we need to stay in this hornet's nest just a little longer, because I was at one of your meetings, and if I'm correct, what happened at that particular meeting was that there was the Quitman Free Press, I believe. I noticed that they did a full-page ad in the Quitman Free Press. I personally went to the editor, and I asked them who paid for that ad. They couldn't tell me. And they couldn't furnish the phone number of who paid it. So I asked her, how much did it cost? And she said $1,000. What do you think about that ad, and who you think just may have published it, if you can say?
Well, I'll just tell you what I think. They would do anything, as Mayor Davis said. There was a pinwheel thing done for the child abuse mother. We stood in front of the city hall and took some pictures. You look in the newspaper, all you see is pinwheels in front of the city hall. So I'm just saying, I think there's, as she said, there's a group of people that paid, because I think it was $996 to be exact.
She told me $1,000.
Oh, okay, well, it's $1,000 for that. And no one has money and equipment like that. So I wouldn't doubt if the Quitman Free Press printed that for free. And I believe that they are, I learned in a political science class that they are supposed to be the watchdogs. They keep everybody in check. Well, there's nobody to keep the media in check. So they print these things. It's all twisted one side. After the meetings, they don't talk to me. But they'll have something on the front page, and it'll be that just one-sided. They don't ask me one question. So I try to figure out, how can they print a one-sided article? And it's becoming so bad that someone has, I think they start May 1st, I can't even remember the name, I should have bought the flyer, they're gonna start printing a free newspaper around there. I think they're gonna put out about 4,000 papers. And this would be for the entire Brooks County. And they asked me if I wanted to have a little section, and I told them yes. So now the people can hear my voice and not just see what the Quitman Free Press wants to put out there. And it is a shame. It is a shame.
My newspaper's biased like that also too. We have did some great positive things in the community, and they never had done.
What's the name of your newspaper?
The Warrenton Clipper. And in that Warrenton Clipper, we even came out. Warrenton is, I did some research, and I hadn't found another city yet. we was the only city that did not have a school traffic light, the flashing beeping light. And I went to my council trying to get it, and then they were saying that it never happened, that we would never get one. And I asked the question why, and I asked all my council, do you have any kids in that school? None of my council, only one of the council has some relative people in that school, and all the rest of them going to private school or somewhere else. And I was concerned about the kids in our school, that no one was thinking about our kids. So I went to the school and the county commission, and we got together. So we do have a traffic light there now. But is it in the paper? No, it's not in the paper. They're protecting our kids. It doesn't have to make the paper, as long as our kids is protected. That's what all works. And being biased in that part, yes, you know, I think the press do not cover the things that we're doing. And I look at it at a point that if you're a black African American, they're not going to report anything positive about anything that you're doing in the community.
Mayor Davis, what has been said by the Attorney General, the Secretary of State, GMA? Has anything been said by them about the situation you're facing as mayor?
Well, as I mentioned, I'm 3 months into my tenure, and I have not had issues that have gone before any of these types of institutions. And I've only gone to trainings at the GMA, and they've been very nice trainings. And I think there's an issue not brought by me, but brought by citizens who are launching a recall in the city of Camilla for violations of open meetings laws. And I think that the state attorney general's office is involved in that, and I hope that they're going to do the right thing. But if I could just say one thing, while we're on the subject of recall, Mayor Harris is going through this recall process, and in Meigs, it's very arduous. The media coverage is consistently negative. We have council persons going through this in Camilla, and it is completely different. Where she is vilified during the recall, they are not. In fact, our local paper reported a false story just recently, last week, that three of the white councils who are being recalled, that the petition failed to get the signatures, and that she was told this by the election superintendent. Well, the election superintendent is the one certified that the signatures were collected and sent it to Superior Court, where there is going to be a hearing, and it is going on, it is proceeding. So why they would report a story that they didn't substantiate or, you know, try to, you know, deceive the public is baffling to me. But in answer to your question, I haven't had any dealings with those organizations.
And to piggyback off of what you just said about the recall, there is a process with that as well. And one reason why they're fighting us is because we don't give up. We have not given up. We're going to fight this fight. And the recall process, you know, there are three phases to it. You get a certain percentage. I think it's 40%. The second time you have to get like 60% of petitioners. And then the third time they send it to, the third phase is they send it to the state so that they can get the, put it on the ballot and all of that. But it's according to who your election superintendent is as well.
Madam Mayor Harris, I must ask you this question. You've been arrested four times. I think two of your brothers, Calvin and
Edward,
was also arrested, like yourself, also put on criminal trespass, removed from your office several times. Do you think that's too much for an elected official by the majority vote to go through for $2,000 a year?
For how much?
$2,000 a year.
Who gets $2,000? You mean my bond or what? We don't get paid.
You don't get paid at all?
We don't get paid at all.
But why you do it?
Well, I do it because like you said, I had a platform. I wanted to help my citizens out there, my constituents. Meigs needed a spokesperson. Every time I went to the council meetings, I've been going to council meetings now probably 10 years religiously. And one, the mayor that I defeated, she came against me because I questioned her integrity, I guess. I questioned the finances. They weren't, when I go to council meetings, I don't just go to work. I'm writing down totals and everything, especially if you get a wind that funds are being misappropriated. So I started getting the totals, and the totals weren't coming out right. They were decreasing, but nothing, no activities going forth for the recreation. And those kids are my passion, you know. So she fought me and said, when I tried to help the kids out and get funds for the recreation, she said, you have a private entity. We're not going to support that.
Okay, are you telling me, excuse me, I'm trying to stay focused as much as I can, but are you telling me that the council members, the mayor, the city clerk, and the attorney don't get paid?
Well, the city attorney gets paid very well. Everybody gets paid except for the mayor and the council.
Okay. And another thing, since we had it, do you think GMA know, have you brought that up at GMA? Have you brought that up to Secretary of State, Attorney General, or the governor's office? Does anybody know that you all are like providing slave labor? And it seems like to me that should be a violation of the labor law.
Exactly. And I feel that if it's a violation for a city employee, if we don't pay our city employees, which the chief of police called the labor union on labor board on me as well, saying that I didn't want to pay them for Thanksgiving. And I feel, and mind you, they were going to be off Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Their regular payday was that Friday. When they got off that Tuesday, is when we started having all our problems with the administration resigning. So we were just getting in, didn't know even who did the payroll. We had to find all that stuff out. So he immediately called anything to go against me. He wanted to do that. So, and I feel like if he can call the labor department, labor union, there should be somewhere or somebody that we can call and reference that.
Well, go ahead, I'm sorry.
Thank you very much for coming.
Wait, did he have one? Go ahead.
I just want to say something right quick.
Sorry.
I thought in order for someone to be an employee that they had to at least receive a dollar payment. There had to be some kind of contract, and it had to be, what's the word, monetary, I guess. So I thought a lot of senators and stuff say they'll take the position for only a dollar a year. So I don't know how you're getting nothing to go through all of this. And if you want to go to training, if they don't pay for it, you can't even pay for it with the money that the city's giving you because they're not giving you any money. So I don't know exactly what they're trying to do and what they expect. Because I think there were some cities that are arguing right now, get full-time council and they'll do a better job instead of volunteers that are trying to do what they can in the spare time that they have with the money that they do or don't have. So I think we do need to check on that.
And I think to add to what you're saying, Mayor, to sum it all up, since we are not getting any answers here in the state of Georgia, maybe we might all need to get together and just ride to Washington, D.C.
and
address our issues.
And I think what he said has valid point because our city administrator, he's very knowledgeable about city government. He worked for the state of Maryland and some in the District of Columbia. So when he came in, we did his contract. He's working for $1. So he knows something about that dollar rule.
Yes.
That he's not telling us, but I mentioned us getting paid. In fact, it's in the minutes that I came across last night, me asking city attorney for us to get, for the council to get paid, the mayor and council. And he says it has to go on the ballot, but it's in our charter, okay? If you says there's a provision in our charter for a city manager, there is a provision, it's already established in our charter for us to be getting paid.
Okay, enough of that. Let Ms. Davis continue. Let's move forward. Thank you, enough of that.
Okay, so I think everybody got a chance to comment on that. I'm going to go to the next one, and I'm going to start with you, Mayor Harris. And I want to know, are they aware of these problems at the Department of Justice? And what about Loretta Lynch? Is she aware of what's going on with you and your problem?
And I think that's what Mayor Lou was just saying. This group right here can be the start of something big, you know, because I'm quite sure there are more cities going through this than what we're going through, but somebody's got to put it out there. It has to start from somewhere. far as Loretta Lynch, I've thought about calling her, but right now I'm battling something, you know, trying to stay out of jail right now. And I, you know, there are funds that's got to be generated for that type of stuff. I mean, even for gas and even to come to this, you know, facility, it wasn't free. Our city don't support these type things. So, you know, it's going to take a coalition to get all of that stuff in place, you know, that we need for support.
Mayor Davis, there's a possibility that somebody probably would say, well, don't call the federal government because this is state, and everybody talking about state rights. But when we talking about the election of a mayor and council, are we not dealing with voting rights? And if they are trying to remove people from office, wouldn't that possibly fall under the federal government, under the Voting Rights Act?
Absolutely. We're dealing with constitutional issues here. When you speak of the Department of Justice, one of their largest divisions is the protection of civil rights, and anyone who has a property interest that is being infringed upon has the right to address it. And so this is absolutely a great idea in terms of, to the extent that black mayors are under assault and discriminated against, they have a property interest in this, and this is a violation of civil rights. And at the federal level, you often can't get some semblance of justice that you can't get often at the state level, because it's the politics, and depending on whose politics, which side of the political side you're on, justice looks different.
And how many of us has Tommy Coleman as the city attorney?
Pardon?
You too?
Yes.
You have Tommy Coleman? Oh, are you serious? He come that far?
And just think, it's got to be a firm representing these cities. Tommy Coleman can, you know, probably represent all of us at the same time. But, and that's where, if our city is getting, if we're getting federal funds, that involves, you know, the Washington. Because where do our funds come from? They have to trickle down from somewhere.
And if I could just say this, I know that we touched on this, but I just want to put it in perspective, because I do have a little insights on this as far as the compensation of elected officials. An elected official doesn't necessarily have to be compensated. You can take the job voluntarily. But almost every charter in the state of Georgia has a provision whereas the council can set the compensation for the elected officials. And what's in the state law says that once you set your salary, it cannot go into effect until you face the voters again in another election. So they can kind of react to what you've set your salary, to where you've set your salary. So I just want to say that. And the other thing I'd like to say is that the salaries of elected officials is a very important issue, because historically that was used as a tool where in my own city as mayor, I think I earn about $3,600 a year. Now, what does that do? For a person who can't devote their time, it's a full-time job,
yes, it is.
Even when it's a part-time job, so to speak.
Exactly.
So if a person can't afford that, then you're discouraging people from taking place and being represented in politics because they're not rich or retired, and it favors that. And that has been a long tool that a lot of states have used, like the state of Texas. They were paying their state senators something like almost $200 or $300 a month or something trivial. But that has long been a very big problem. So it is very important that government has salaries for officials who are stewards of the public.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Worthy. Your name wasn't on that flyer for it, for the meeting, as a supporter?
Who held the meeting? You asked me a question. I'm asking you, who held the meeting?
I did, and you didn't answer it. Wasn't your name on that flyer?
I held the meeting. Sure, my name would be on it.
Okay, well,
see, that's where you went wrong.
That's all we said.
No, that's not all you said. That's not all you said. You said supported by Commissioner Pearson. What was supported by Commissioner Pearson?
The meeting
that I called, that's exactly right. I called the meeting. Justice League did not call the meeting, first and foremost. They didn't call the meeting. I held a meeting through Southern Rural Black Women's Initiative for Economic and Social Justice. I invited Mr. Bobby Worthy and the NAACP. Let me finish, Mr. Hudson.
That was the point of the article, the mention of you.
No. You claim that the Justice League held this meeting, which was a lie. It was a lie. You said it, as well as the Douglas Enterprise said it. Justice League did not hold a meeting here in Douglas, Georgia. Southern Rural Black Women's Initiative held a meeting. I invited Mr. Worthy. I invited Ms. O'Hara as district rep for the NAACP. I invited Mr. Hal Presley. And matter of fact, I invited the entire community of the city of Douglas, Coffee County, Georgia. I announced it on my city council meeting. So why in the world, tell me, would I hold a meeting that's gonna succumb to or support hatred towards white people or any other people? Why would I hold a public announcement of a meeting like that? I haven't been in office for 15 years to do something so low down and dirty. See, you had your facts, you had your statements incorrect. Had you all given us the respect and decency to come and ask a question, Ed, you were at the meeting when I announced about that flyer. If you had a concern or an issue about it being to hate white folks or kill white folks, seemed like to me you would have had the courtesy, being that you were there, to have came to me, Commissioner Pearson, what is this about? But no, not one of you. Not one of you journalism fellas or lady, I'm not sure what part you played in it, so if you did play a part, excuse that comment. Not one of you had the decency or respect to come to me as an elected official and ask the question, what is this all about? A decent journalist who is seeking the truth has a moral and ethical obligation to go and get both sides of a story and not just print one side and not just assume. And none of you did that. So yes, I feel my life is threatened with something like this. And you sat there when Mr. Presley asked the question, have you gotten any feedback from anybody? Nobody would say anything. You didn't answer it. But I already know the answer to it. You've gotten feedback. Because I've gotten feedback. I've gotten feedback from white people. I've gotten feedback from black people. And they're not satisfied with it, black or white. And they have all said to me, Olivia, we know that's not true. So some people who might not know me might not know. But those who know me know I wouldn't take part in anything that's going to deal with hatred or killing or anything in breaking the law. So on now today, you all want to come and be a part of this press release, this news conference on today, after you have done your damage. Because like I say, damage has been done. Because don't everybody know all of us and what we stand for. It's just the grace of God that those who do know us know we wouldn't dare partake of any such foolishness.
Amen.
And I feel like what you're doing is displaying what you have in your heart.
Amen.
To print something like this.
Amen.
Yes.
Yes.
I can say to you, not one of you have ever had me to say anything racist to you, to say anything about hatred to you. In dealing with your media and dealing with me, none of you can say that I've ever said anything racist.
Right.
If it's right, if it's a fact about what has happened, and it might tend to lead judge. He knows my heart. And no, I wouldn't partake of anything such as this that you all have intended to influence this community to believe.
Amen.
And so, ridiculous.
That's right.
It's totally unacceptable. And we are not going to tolerate it. Mm-hmm. So now you want to go and dig and talk about the use of the Coley Center. Mm. Get the records about the Coley Center. You dig on and see what you find. If anybody got any money for using the Coley Center, it definitely was not Commissioner Olivia Coley Pearson.
Right?
I have never used the Coley Center or any facility of the City of Douglas in an inappropriate manner. That's why I announced the meeting of that we were having on October 3rd. That's why I announced it at my city council meeting. And I said then, anybody who is concerned about the community and would like to help and take part, please come. That was my request. But you all are tending to try to divide this community more and more and more. I'm concerned as to who employs the Douglas Knight employees, as well as the Douglas Enterprise. What do these people stand for? I'm really surprised at this time. I'm surprised because your editor should have told you, go get the other side, see what they have to say about it before we print this.
Should have been fact checked.
It should have been.
Should have been fact checked.
And it's sad. It's sad because it's too late in the day with too much everything that's going on in our surroundings and our communities and our different states. It's too much and too late in the day to try to print something like this to make white folk feel that they need to go and buy guns, which was announced at a church. Announced at church by a white lady that she needs to go and buy a gun because of this group that has been formed. And I suggest to the rest of y'all that y'all go buy one, is what she was quoted as saying. So if it's in y'all's heart to cause this kind of deliberate tension and division, you need to go check yourselves.
They damage the community.
You need to go check yourselves. God is not pleased. God is not pleased. When I chose to run for office, I found all kind of opposition. Some by black folks, but some by white folks. And ever since I've been in office, I've had to deal with you all saying statements that were not true, trying to blemish my name. So whatever it is you're seeking, I hope you find it. But I can tell you, my name is not going to be blemished because the people know what I stand for. When I talk to the white city employees, Commissioner Pearson, we know you're not like that. But like I say, my concern is the people who do not know me. Who do not know me.
Amen.
Because my mother, an honorable woman, who I got emails and texts from people telling me when I expressed what was going on my Facebook page, they said, we know what your mother stood for. We know she didn't raise you that way. Mm-hmm. But I'm wondering, how have you all been raised? Mm-hmm. Yes, I'm wondering today.
Right.
I'm wondering today. Because somebody from the media should have had the decency to see the true facts. So justice would be known and would prevail.
That's right.
This plaque, since you all say recent altercation shines light on new militant organization, that's what y'all said. That's what y'all said. I'm trying to find out where is this militant organization at. Because it's not us. It's not us. Some of us can barely walk. We are elderly. Walking with sticks. But we are militant. Because we state what is the truth. We're seeking to make the community better, which is what I said at that city council meeting when I announced that meeting on October 3rd. So how did militant organization come out of it? It's wrong. The meeting I had, Southern Rural Black Women, has been here in Douglas Coffee County since 1999. And I was asked to chair and lead this group. Southern Rural Black Women's Initiative for Economic and Social Justice. Not just justice for black people, or black women, but it's geared toward women, because women have had a difficult time finding daycare, someone to keep their kids so they can go to work, trying to finish and get a GED so they can get a good job. That's why this group was formed and has received federal monies and money from private groups to help people who are a part of this to better their lives. And you would take the meeting we held
which was held, hosted by Southern Rule Black Women, and distort the facts. Shame on you.
I am Bobby Worthy, the national president for the Justice League United. I have marched in Ferguson, Missouri. I have been in Emmanuel 9, Charleston, South Carolina, Walter Scott, Trayvon Martin, Jordan Davis. I go all over the country fighting injustice. Kendrick Johnson, we're working over in his case now, Kendrick Johnson. But I'm here to tell you, black people, we got to get it together. We got to get it together, because if we don't get it together, we're going to be back in bondage for these white folks' wounds. And I'm going to tell you now, and I hate to say this, I'm going to be sure, the United States government, I served 6 years. And I am appalled at what's going on in our government. I'm just being real. Now, we need to get it real. We got all these elected officials that's in this country. Oh, we know how to give a good sermon just like the pastor on Sunday. But how many of y'all have seen him on the battlefield? How many of y'all seen him stand before Kendrick Johnson? How many of y'all seen him stand for Jordan Davis? 17 years old. All of us are going to die off. If we don't get to our youth, then we going to die off. Because they're going to lock the half of them up in jail. The rest of them they're going to kill. We got to start at the age of a baby training our children to be how black men at a baby to try to teach them how to treat their black queens. Believe it, sisters, you are the mother of this earth.
That's right.
The black woman.
That's right. That's right.
You were kings and queens before they kidnapped us. Now, I suggest y'all, I'm gonna be brief. I suggest if y'all haven't done it, I need y'all to go see Hidden Colors.
Hidden.
1, 2, 3, and 4.
Hidden Colors.
Hidden Colors. 1, 2, 3, and 4. And if you can't get a copy of it, get with me, I'll get you a copy, all three. Every black man, woman, and child need to see this, and you'll see the plan that these people have done for you. And I'm asking y'all this, how many people know that the original Statue of Liberty? What was the original Statue of Liberty? How many people know?
The black woman.
The original Statue of Liberty was to symbolize the end of slavery. But the white folks got together and did not want to see that in the harbor. It was a woman with hands
and
chains on her feet and hands, a black woman. They changed the design. So they didn't want that in the harbor. But if you look at the Statue of Liberty today, the designers did not want to change it completely. The Statue of Liberty today, look at the pictures of, have chains on the feet. The Statue of Liberty today has chains on the feet. White folks. And then people tell, oh, Mr. Worthy, you talk like a racist. Ha, really? My mama's white. Nice try, though. I talk like I hate injustice. I don't care if you're black, white, Jew, Chinese, or what. I hate injustice. And I go all around the country. Miss Olivia, I've been knowing her for a while, and I'm here to tell you, and because of the city of Douglas, choices in a situation that happened with me, because the choice that they took 27 minutes to put me in handcuffs, and said, Mr. Worthy, you will be in arrest, and put me in a car for 27 minutes. Now the city of Douglas is getting ready to battle a federal lawsuit for $1 million.
Yeah.
False arrest, false imprisonment, and malicious prosecution. I hope that country boy lawyer word. No disrespect to Olivia, y'all right. City of Florida, right. But we got to do what I do. We got to learn to let these police know that the laws are in place to protect the citizens, not you. You know what I'm saying? It's protect the citizen from the abuse of the government. Let me tell you, there's a security issue for the United States Constitution. I say snakes, but the United States Constitution. There's a security issue called the Declaration of Independence. The Declaration of Independence clearly says that when any form of government becomes destructive
of its means. The power reverts back to the people, and it's up to the people to alter, abolish, and institute a new government. We have the power to tell the U.S. government, the federal government, the state government, local, you are done. It's over with. We don't need you no more if you can't do what you're supposed to do.
Amen.
Now, as a member of the Black Lawyers of Justice, Attorney Billy Zulu Shabazz marched up and down the streets of Ferguson in the rain with tear gas thrown at us to keep these people organized from tearing up the city. And as a result, the city is getting ready to fight a battle of $60 million lawsuit. White folks don't understand nothing. We can march. We can protest. Uh-huh. We even date their children. Want them one thing. One thing they understand is taking money out of their pocket. Take that money from their pocket. And then I'm going to tell y'all this. The national boycott. If y'all go to, it's on my, I got some business cards. I'll give them out if you want them. It's called the nationalblackout.org. You go on to there and you'll see all the black businesses registered where even the Honorable Minister Farrakhan is calling for a blackout. Take that dollar. Spend your dollars on black-owned businesses. And black-owned businesses only. And what? That's the way these people going to understand.
Amen. Amen.
That's what made the great Montgomery so great.
That's right.
The mayor came and told a great friend of mine that I know and said, I don't care what you do, get my niggas back in here shopping. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's power. You know what I'm saying? But see, white folks don't understand the word nigga. You know, we use it so fluently, but I say, oh, what's up, my nigga? We shouldn't use that word because it's derogatory. But I had a white woman tell me, why you call me a nigga on Facebook? I said, well, if you look up the definition of nigga, ma'am, then you can, mama can be a nigga. It means an ignorant person. So you, it can be white, too. But let's get it together. Get our youth. Black
power.
Thank you,
Father. Let's go. Brother Carlos, would you want to say a word right quick?
I will say this is being spirit and truth.
Yes, sir.
In the whole matter here. Right here in Douglas, Georgia, I'm going to sit here and say, I was sitting here hurt and pain to see these chairs in the pulpit and all around that my ministers were not standing, my brother and sister in Coffee County were not standing. We got to be in spirit and truth. The question that I want everybody to go to bed with tonight and ask yourself in the spirit of truth, am I my brother's keeper?
All right.
That's the question we all got to ask ourselves. Mm-hmm. Am I my brother's keeper? And we got to say it in spirit of truth. Because you can't lie to the great God up above.
Amen.
Because right now we need unity. We need solidarity. Mm-hmm. We don't need political propaganda. We need soldiers on the battlefield. Mm-hmm. We need for our men to stand back in front. So our ladies, go out right now. When you go on Facebook, tell your man to stand up.
Yes.
Amen. That's what I'm talking about.
We must stand up.
Yes.
We must unify.
Yes, sir.
The weakest link can't stand for us. We got to be the strongest link.
Yes.
The men of the Most High God. In Douglas, Georgia, we will stand. My brothers and sisters, we have your back. Black footprint and boss. But that title doesn't mean nothing.
All
we're
right.
Service of the Most High God. Thank you.
Beautiful, my brother. Beautiful, my brother.
All right. Brother Curtis has let me know the fish is ready. So what we're going to do, we're going to have any minister from the pulpit got a word. You sure, Pastor Anthony?
Just fight on. I'm happy to see Senator Representative Lucas. He and I went to school together. In the year 1963, we went to Washington, D.C. President John Fitzgerald Kennedy was in office. We not only went to Washington, D.C., but we went in the White House. Mm-hmm. I'm just happy to see him tonight. Fight on.
Amen.
Fight on.
Let's go.
Hold all the way down.
You ready? Before he give us that closing prayer, we're going to all get ready to stand. We'll let him give us closing prayer and grace. But I just like to say, if you all are free on tomorrow, 3 o'clock p.m., Gladys Coley Center, Southern Rural Black Women's Initiative for Social and Economic Justice, will be meeting 3 o'clock, Gladys Coley Center tomorrow. 3 o'clock, we're going to take a bus to Atlanta to meet with state representatives and state senators at the Capitol on September the 10th. So, but tomorrow is the signing up meeting for that. If you can come out, come out. Thank you.
Sister Chris, I want you to take a chair.
two to take a chair, and then we're going to pray for the Douglas Four.
Oh, okay.
Two that are here, the two out here. And I want the ministers, if you believe in the power of prayer,
right.
I want the ministers to come and lay hands on them. Okay. If you don't believe in the power of prayer, what are you doing? Give me four chairs. Give me one more chair.
Give me one more chair.
One more chair.
I got
two for
right
the two here,
here
and then two for right the two here. That's not here.
Oh,
wow.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Amen. With the blessing of Reverend Anthony and those who are believing in the power of prayer. To lay hands on these two. And the rest of you who believe in the power of prayer, I want you to point your hands toward these two.
All right.
Yes, Lord. And let us pray.
Yes.
My dear Heavenly Father, we can do nothing without you. Those of us who are followers of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ know that you are omniscient. You know everything.
Yes.
You're everywhere at the same time.
Yes.
And you are omnipotent. You have all power, and authority.
So we
pray, Lord, for the Douglas Four.
Yes.
Father, we're not afraid because we know that you can do anything but fail. Strengthen these two that are present and the two that are not present. Strengthen the people that are being responsible for their legal defense. Strengthen the community to support them financially. That they may be able to stand and not be persecuted. Father, we know that Paul and Silas was in a Roman jail. But at midnight, Paul and Silas were singing and praying. And an earthquake came and shut the doors open. Lord, we're not dependent on an earthquake. We're dependent on strong legal representation to make sure that the Douglas Four are not mistreated. Are not unfairly persecuted. And incarcerated. Father, we claim this in Jesus' name. By the blood you shed on Calvary. And Father, we understand that if a prayer don't go pocket deep, it won't go sky high. So we want the community to know that these four need funds for legal representation. Father, help people to support and share their resources to help these four. Then Father, bless this food for the nourishment of our body.
Lord,
we thank the people who made it possible.
Lord.
We thank the people who prepared. In Jesus Christ's name. Repeat after me, and let us not be weary
in
well doing.
For in due season,
we shall reap.
We shall reap
if we faint.
If we faint
not.
Amen. Glory to God.
Hey, we have stuff in the kitchen. Y'all go get some.
Y'all, everybody stay and eat, please.
Senator Lucas, God bless you, brother. Thank you so much, brother. Thank you so much, man.
Hey, brother. You got a card. Bless you, man. Senator Lucas,
God bless you, God bless you.
You know CCM's?
How you doing?
CCM's from Gary Oakley.
I probably know if I see him.
No, female. CCM's.
Yes,
always. Clayton County. She, female, CC. And if y'all with Gabrielle, she's always in the NAACP.
Yeah, I do.